I would like to take a brief moment to begin our event with the Negro National Anthem. Afterwards, Chantel Dixon, another wonderful student from history. And it is really Chantel who deserves much of the credit for this event. In January of this year, she began a senior thesis on the history of the Black Student Union, and in doing so interviewed Larry Gossett, and I think that really planted the seed, at least for me, to bring him to campus, to invite him to campus to talk about the Black Student Union. I won't say any more with that. I will simply begin the Negro National Anthem. And as all national anthems might require, I ask you to stand.
Thank you. Larry Gossett grew up in South and Central Seattle in the 1950s and 60s. In the late 1960s, he became one of Seattle's best-known young Black radicals. He was active in Seattle's Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in 1967 and co-founded the University of Washington's Black Student Union in 1968. Through the BSU, Gossett helped push UW to create a Black Studies program. He also helped organize a dozen high school and middle school Black student unions throughout the city. As a pioneering staff member of the UW's Office of Minority Affairs from 1970 to 73, he helped found some of the key institutions for promoting and sustaining racial and economic diversity at the UW. Gossett developed a close relationship with activists for radical justice outside the Black community, and along with Bernie Whitebeer, Bob Santos, and Roberto Maestas, nicknamed the Gang of Four, founded the Minority Executive Directors Coalition in 1982. Gossett served as an executive director of Central Area Motivation Program from 1979 to 1993, after which he was elected to the King County Council, where he continues to represent the 2nd District. It is my pleasure to introduce to you guys Mr. Larry Gossett.
Thank you very much, Chantel, for the very gracious and nice and accurate introduction. The reason I added accurate, I've been an elected official. I need Chantel and Professor Adams to pass out those brochures at this time, because I'd like everyone to have one. But I've been a politician for 21 years, and still, about one-fifth of the time that I'm introduced, they get everything right, and then at the end they say, without further ado, I present to you City Councilmember Larry Gossett. And the first thing I have to do is correct the person doing the introduction, but I did not have to do that, thanks to the good homework that Chantel did. I would like to start my presentation about the early history of the Black Student Union by first talking about Baltimore, Maryland. Baltimore, Maryland, right now. I think that history tends to have more meaning when you're able to relate it to things that are happening presently. And I can't think of anything happening more present that relates to the history of the Black Student Union and history and the struggle of Black people for full freedom in this country, more so than the growing hostility and conflict between low-income, working-class African Americans, particularly Black males, and the police department. Not only in Baltimore, but all throughout our country, including Tacoma and Seattle. Looking at CNN and NSBC and other news, I don't understand why the majority of the conversation is mostly about whether or not protesters should get involved, and it was necessary for them to get involved in violence. And it's rare that you hear very much of the conversation having to do with why is it that over the last 7 years, on average, 300 to 400 African American males have been killed by police officers in this country. And I think it's legitimate to say, why is it that over the last 5 years, on average, between 23 and 27 police officers have been killed in this United States? And I really think, as a politician, we are remiss if we don't also talk about the fact that of all the homicides in the United States of America. And in 2014, there were 650 black men and women murdered in the United States of America. And 93% of those who murdered them are other African American men from the same class and background as these. For the same year, there were only 516 white men who were murdered, but 78% of the people who murdered them were other white people. We do not want to talk about the real issues related to race, I would contend, in this country. And it's kind of sad because many of these issues about black oppression and disadvantagement in our country, we were talking about in the 1960s, and we naively, as young college students, thought that by 1975, the black revolutionary struggle would be over and that we would be on the winning side by 1975. And we used to have meetings with white radicals that were part of the Seattle Liberation Front and the Students for a Democratic Society in 68 and 69 and 70, talking about how we were going to take state power and then make America what America is truly supposed to be and has always professed. But we have to start talking about race in the context of what really, in reality, is happening. The violence of breaking windows and stuff like that, although it should be talked about, but it's not comparable to the breaking of backs and larynxes, because most of the windows can be fixed. And we have to talk about why, out of frustration, people would be hitting the streets where they'd have majority peaceful demonstrations, but a growing number are involved in what I call urban rebellion. And I'm going to leave some time for questions so that you all would be able to ask me questions. But I'm very happy, and I think I'd be remiss if I don't introduce Larry Toots, who came out here with me. Where's Larry? Okay. Larry, in 1968, participated with me in one of the most profoundly impactful, because it was the first sit-in in Washington State history, sit-ins in our state's history, and that was at Franklin High School on March 29, 1968. And he and I have been close friends ever since then. So, in order to more meaningfully have discussions around race and African American history, we have to kind of look at what's happening in our society today and then go back. Now I'm going to go back and try to help people understand why it's still difficult for most whites and too many blacks, because blacks said, I'm tired of talking to white folks. They don't want to listen. And being only 12% of the population, we are going to have coalitions with other progressive-minded people in this society if we're to make the kind of reforms that are still necessary as we meet here on the evening of May 6, 2015. To talk about the Black Student Union, I need to tell you my background. I was born in Seattle, Washington. It's really paradoxical because I'm a King County Council member and all of you have my brochure now, but I was born at King County Hospital. I don't even know if Julia Gary knows that. Did you know that, Julia? One of y'all's professors. I was born in 1945. My parents were part of a great migration of African American peoples from the South to northern cities in order to strive for and hopefully get better economic opportunities up here than they got in the South. And one of the motivating forces for coming to cities like Oakland and Seattle and Detroit, it was because of the burgeoning war industry that was going on here, and most white men of 20s, 30s, 40s were fighting in the war, and there was a desperate need for women. Any of y'all ever heard of Rosie the Riveter? Rosie and the women that worked at Boeing were as badass. And often you might hear me say bad, and y'all know I mean good, right? These women were bad with these machines doing riveting. They made the planes probably better than the men because they stayed more focused and disciplined when they were building planes out in Boeing. But in 1943, Boeing finally allowed in other war industries out of necessity, not necessarily out of courage to do the right thing as it relates to the provision of decent paying jobs for African Americans, allowed black people to work there. Because if their motivation had been more altruistic, we want to do the right thing, Boeing began in 1921. Why are you going to wait 22 years before you hire your first person of African descent? How come Todd Shipyard, you started in the 1930s, and you hire your first person of African-American descent in 42? Why, Bethlehem Steele, did you start in 1928 in Seattle, Washington, and hire your first black worker in 1943? So my parents came up here because of the racial terror that existed in the South at that time. My daddy picked 150 pounds of cotton in the summer of 43, and the way they measure stuff, he was supposed to get $1.50. 6 a.m. to 6 a.m., $1.50. The white foreman said, boy, all you're going to get is 90 cents. And my daddy talked up just a little bit. Well, I'm supposed to get $1.25. He said, shut up, boy, before you get hurt. And my daddy knew, because of the nature of racial segregation and racial terror in the South in 1944, because you see, in Lufkin and Tyler and Nickton, Texas at that time, there were 44,000 black people, and only five of them were registered to vote. And only one of them in the previous 20 years to 1943 had the nerve to actually go down and try to vote. So the black population had no power whatsoever where my father was living. So he had to be quiet. At the same time, my mother's sister, who was living in Seattle, Washington, wrote them a letter and said, there are jobs up here for Negroes. Because that's what we even called ourselves back in those days. And my daddy jumped at the opportunity. And it's a long ways from East Texas to Seattle. About, a lot of miles, 12, 14,000, I don't know. It's a lot of miles. It took them 1-2 days. And they knew that anywhere in the South, they were not going to be able to stop at the gas station and get some gas and go to the bathroom or stop at a hotel because they're tired and get a room. Why not? Right. They had the clean kitchen. Man, I like these young people, Professor Woody Hodge. She's right. It was illegal for black people to use the same water fountain, either at the hotel or the gas station. That's why it was illegal for blacks to use the bathroom at all at the filling station. And most hotels in Texas, and even in the border towns of New Mexico, on their way up to Seattle, did not allow blacks. So they definitely had to sleep in the car that they were in. So they came up to Seattle. And got here April of 1944, and then commenced to having six kids. But my dad got a job at Todd Shipyard. This is the point, the economic point I like to make, and then I need to move forward. He made a dollar an hour at Todd Shipyard as a ship scaler. Hard work. But what's one times eight?
$8.
Damn, this girl got it going on. He was making $8. What did I tell you a minute ago? Working in a hot sun in Texas, 90 cents, 12 hours. It's a little difference, ain't it?
Yes.
Right? She'd rather get the $8 than the $1. That's a common sense thing, but it's still difficult for the African Americans came here. In 1940, there were 1,400 black people living in Seattle, Washington. By 1950, that increase had gone to 12,000 black people. By 1960, it was 30,000 black people that lived in Seattle. Tremendous increase in population. But it was still a small minority within the broader context of Seattle, Washington. And then my mother went to have a baby in February of 1945 at King County Hospital, and they took her to a certain room that they had reserved for, it shocked her, a room where everybody in there was colored girls. They may not have had a sign, but all the women in there were colored girls, as the nurses said. And they said, y'all know about having babies, so we'll be back here later. And there was no doctor or nurses home because they thought she knew what to do. She didn't know what to do. So when little Larry came out, luckily she had seen a film, and the film said, you spank the new baby's behind, and if he cried, he probably all right, or she. So she spanked my behind and I came out. And it was only then that the nurses came forward. Seattle also was a racist place, but economically it was better than where it was that they came from. The only time that the namesake of King County, Martin Luther King Jr., ever visited Washington State was a visit that he made to Seattle, Washington on November 8th. All of y'all that are scholars and researchers, okay, well, yeah, but I got to tell the others. Would it be all right if I tell the others? Okay, she said I can tell y'all about it. So he came to Seattle on November 8, 1961, because Reverend McKinney, the pastor at Mount Zion Baptist Church, who had been his schoolmate at Morehouse College, which was a historically black college in the South, because blacks were not allowed in the 1940s when these two gentlemen were in school to go to school with whites. So they both went to Morehouse. But Morehouse is considered one of the black, if not the premier black college in our country when they went there. So he called him, he came. The issue in Seattle in 1961 was housing segregation. Martin Luther King was not allowed to speak at any church that held 500 or more people. Three churches turned him down as a speaker. One, was on Capitol Hill, and it was a Baptist church, and they did say yes, but they got so much heat from their Congregationists about having this Martin Luther King was considered a radical Negro come and speak, that they had to ask, disinvite him and not allow him to speak. The only places where Martin Luther King was able to speak in Seattle were at Garfield High School. In 1961, Garfield High School was the only high school in the state of Washington that had a student body population of more than 50%. The blacks were about 55%. And Martin was allowed to talk to them. By that time, I as a 10th grader, I went to Garfield High School, but the 11th, 12th, I went to Franklin. So we skipped, the 20 or 30 of us that were black students of Franklin skipped and went up to Garfield to hear Martin Luther King speak. But we really didn't think about racism, and we never talked about it very much in Seattle. And we were shocked when Martin Luther King said the following. Seattle, Washington is the fifth most segregated city in these United States of America, according to various national studies that look at issues like housing segregation. In Seattle, Washington, in 1961, I already told y'all there was about 32,000 blacks living here. 88% of us lived in the central area. So Garfield had 1,050 black students. Franklin had 20, we had about 40 black students. Cleveland had 16, Rainier Beach had 2, and we had a very difficult time finding anywhere else in Seattle, except when we go out to West Seattle and look at the biggest housing project in our city, High Point and South had about 20 black students in 1961. So it was very segregated. And that's the first time I ever thought about racism in my life. I was 14 years old, 15 years old, Martin Luther King was speaking here, and I thought about it. After I graduated from high school in 1963, because I was into basketball and got good grades because I wanted to play college ball, I was fortunate enough to be accepted into the University of Washington, fall quarter, 1963. At that time, there were 25 black students on the entire campus of about 32,000. It wasn't until 1968 that we organized the first black student union on the University of Washington campus in order to combat racism. And it's because black students all across this country were redefining what their role ought to be as young students, as young activists, as young intellectuals, if we were to participate in the Black Power movement. And many of us in the 60s were attracted to the civil rights and the Black Power movement because, and I don't think we would have been had all our parents stayed down south, the racism was so suffocating in the 13 southern states of the United States in the 40s and 50s, it would have been very difficult until the civil rights movement started to be talking about black power. But indeed, the concept of black power was first articulated in Mississippi by Stokely Carmichael, one of the great leaders of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. And he articulated this new concept of black power, black people taking control over their own destinies in June of 1966. By June of 1966, the Vietnam War was going on. So many of us in college, including myself, were very concerned about the Vietnam War and didn't see the connection about us needing to go over there, meaning our government, and fight Vietnamese people. And this was white, black, Latino, Asian. A lot of students were questioning the war in Vietnam, and I was one of them. But in order not to go, I joined VISTA in 1966. What is VISTA? Anybody? Yes. Okay. It actually precedes AmeriCorps. It was the first, mostly youth, but we always had a core group of elder volunteers. First domestic peace corps established in the United States. It was VISTA. And legislation was passed for it under the Office of Economic Opportunity set up by President Johnson in 1964 to combat poverty in America. So VISTA was like the domestic peace corps. At the same time, the Peace Corps was set up, but that was to work in nations, to volunteer for 2 years in nations across outside the country. VISTA, 1 year service in communities in the United States of America and then back home. My participation in VISTA, I would like to assert to all of you students here at University of Washington Tacoma branch, was the most profoundly impactful signature experience of my life. Here's why. I joined VISTA in March of 66, and I was sent to Toledo, Ohio to be trained. And even though I was a sophomore at the University of Washington, credit-wise, I never read any book that was written by or about Black, Asian, Latino, or Native American people in my life. I didn't know anything about the Black experience in this country, or anything about community organizing, or that Black people were oppressed people that needed to rise up and fight against their oppression. So when I went into VISTA, all VISTA volunteers have to live in and work in low-income communities. So they introduced me to books like Rules for Radicals by Saul Alinsky. By a show of hands, how many of y'all have seen, at least walked by or seen or heard of that book? Oh, very good. Okay. Another book that we read in 1966 was Claude Brown's. Somebody over here, what's the name of it? Thank you. Man, Child, and the Promised Land. We got that book. Michael Harrington was the first socialist writer that I ever had any exposure to, and I was almost a junior at the University of Washington. And he wrote a book called The Other America. And we had to read that in training to become VISTA volunteers for 8 weeks. And then after I got out of training, they sent me to Central Harlem. Anybody ever heard of that community?
Yeah,
it's in Harlem, New York. Harlem, the highest concentration of people of African descent of any other geographic area in the world at that time, because it's being gentrified now. In the world, in Harlem, when I got there June 3rd, 1966, there was one from 110th Street to 155th Street, and from 7th Avenue, about seven blocks over, 566,000 people, all of whom were African American or Puerto Rican for the most part. 566,000 people. In Harlem, when I landed there, there was one high school. And the reason I remember so well, the high school had the same name as the high school that I had attended, Franklin High School. Paradoxically, Seattle, Washington in 1966 had a population of about 570,000 people, about the same. But you got to get in a car and drive a while to get to all the neighborhoods of Seattle. And we had 14 high schools. And if you'd gone to a school board meeting in 66, a whole bunch of parents said, this ain't enough. We need a couple new high schools. Yet in Harlem, they had one high school. And you pick up the New York Times or the Amsterdam News, the Black newspaper, and people were acting surprised that 73% of all the ninth graders in Harlem were dropping out of school. I was assigned to work on 117th between 7th, it's Malcolm X Boulevard now, and Lenox Avenues. First thing we had to do is a survey. I live in the Central area. Now, it is true, the Central area is all Black, but it don't have the population of that. I lived on 18th and Alder. If I were to go from 18th and Alder to 19th and Alder, at the most, there was about 66 people on this side of the street and about 70 on the other side, 130. Listen to the results of this survey from the block that I worked on. And because conceptually, they said, well, you're going to be tutoring kids under the age of 12 and providing recreational activities for them. My context was Seattle, Washington. About 9 or 10 kids under 12 in my block at most. Okay? We did our survey. Listen to this. It's very sad. 7,800 people, 1,540 under the age of 12 on that one block. That's how many people live. were packed in Harlem. About 55%, it's kind of paradoxical because the poverty level in Harlem wasn't that much greater than Seattle, but the intensity of the number of people was overwhelming. Now, how I'm going to tutor, you know, over 1,000 kids under 12, and at that time, glue sniffing amongst kids 12 and under, dabbling in weed, a little bit in heroin, even under 12, was quite significant as a response to the oppressive conditions under which the people in this part of New York City lived. And when Stokely Carmichael in June, about a week after I got there, articulated the concept of Black Power, it resonated so well in Harlem, it just zoomed through that ghetto. And what helped, June of 1966 is only a year and 3 months after the death of Malcolm X, who was brutally murdered in Harlem, but was still profoundly influential, and his philosophical teachings laid the foundation for Black Power. So it was really easy for the masses of people in Harlem to be attracted to this new concept of Black Power. And they tied it to one of Malcolm X's favorite mantra, and that he used to talk about when he'd stand on the corner of 125th and Lenox Avenue and give speeches. He said, "I don't know what's wrong with Martin Luther King. Come on, man. If somebody hit me on one of my cheeks, why in the hell am I going to turn the other and let him hit me there? I don't understand. That's how Malcolm talked. If he hit me, I'm going to try my best to send him to the cemetery." He used to say stuff, and the crowd would just yell because they could relate to what he was saying. And he said, "We have to be willing to gain our freedom by any means necessary." Any means. Remember, this is all before Black Power. Huh? Yeah, he was for a while. He was a very good friend of Muhammad Ali. He's the primary Black Muslim that attracted Muhammad Ali to the Black Muslims. And then after Muhammad Ali won the world championship in 64, he announced that y'all stop calling me by my slave name, Cassius Clay, and call me Muhammad Ali. What's a slave name? I don't want you to answer. What do you think Cassius Clay mean that he didn't want to use his slave name? Anybody? Yes, sir. Very good. Look at that brochure. I'm going to see if y'all believe this, but it's true. Julia, you know I wouldn't tell him nothing wasn't true. Two people on there. I mentioned one day about my slave name being Larry Gossett. He said, "What are you talking about?" And I was kind of shocked. No, they got to be kidding. But I thought maybe they'd not. I said, "Well, do you know how Black people got their names in this country?" They said, "Y'all always had these names." Oh my God, elected official, talking like that. I said, "No, most of us, 96, yeah. And there's some Black people, they love to argue about, I'm a descendant of one of the free Black families." I said, "Okay, there's 4% free Blacks. You might be a descendant, but you're catching hell as a Black man and woman now. So you still got to get involved." So most Black people in the United States of America got their names from their masters. I trace mine because I'm a historian by training. I was the first student at the University of Washington ever trained to specially teach African-American history. And most of my professors, I was the one, because I lived in Harlem and been around a little bit and read some Black history and wanted very much to major in it. I had to teach them where source documents were that I could use so they could legitimately give me an A or an A minus. so that I could graduate from the, because they had no reference point. I was telling somebody a little earlier, Woody, about Elijah McCoy. Who's that I was telling about Elijah McCoy? Wasn't that you? Say something. All right. Who is Elijah McCoy? He's okay. Has any of you ever heard the concept or ever used the concept, man, this is the real McCoy in your movies around? Okay. Anybody else? Okay, yeah. Okay. I probably could count on my hands the number of people in here that know that that concept, this is why, the reason I brought it up to her, I told her that there was some white professors at the University of Washington in 1968 when we demanded black studies. They said, black people don't have no history. Asian people don't have no history. Latino people don't have no history. Oh, where did the concept of zero come from? Julia? The Aztecs. But we don't have no history. Then he made a mistake of saying, it's not the real McCoy, what y'all talking about in the Black Student Union. Oh, where'd that concept come from? He didn't know. So I explained to him in 1883, Elijah McCoy, a very creative, not well educated, but he knew enough, inventor, I think it was in Ohio, figured out a way to automatically lubricate motors in trains and ships. The two primary modes of transportation in America, and one of the most difficult times that the big robber barons in the 1870s, 1880s were having, they couldn't go very far without having to oil the motors. It didn't run automatically for buku miles. Buku is another ghetto term, but I don't have time to tell y'all what it is, what it means. But it's a long ways, suffice that to say. Elijah figured out a way to automatically lubricate motors. And had invention, took it to the robber barons, barons that ran the industry, the train industry, and showed them what it could do. They got excited. But they didn't want to pay the brother anything for his invention. He said, no. Come on, I might look crazy. I ain't that crazy to give you all this invention for nothing. So they said what they usually say, okay, we'll get some intellectually well-educated white inventors in this country, or we'll go to Europe if we have to, and they'll duplicate what you invented. 19 months, they went all over the country, all over the world, and they couldn't find anybody that could put together a system that would automatically lubricate their motors in the manner that Elijah McCoy did. So it was in the boardrooms of these big companies, and they're very influential in American society, that they started out of frustration saying, damn, man, we bought this cat all the way from France and this one from England. And what they did ain't even the real McCoy. They couldn't manufacture what Elijah had done. So the concept of the real McCoy came into our culture, into our language, to mean no matter how you try, you're not able to really do it well, and it's not real. Like the historian said, black people didn't contribute anything to history. It's not real. It's not the real McCoy. But these stupid guys didn't even know about how this concept entered mainstream American cultural life. So they had to go back and pay him, and he got paid a decent amount, but he wanted to set up companies, and they wouldn't allow that, but he got paid for the work that he did. So after I got out of Vista in 1967 and came back to Seattle, I was on fire for wanting to get involved in the Black Power movement. So I went back to I joined Seattle SNCC because Stokely Carmichael had visited Seattle on April 8, 1967. Is that about right, Woody? Yeah. And he had a profound impact on Seattle's black community. Nearly 2,500 people filled Garfield High School gym And they all went in there calling themselves colored and Negroes, stuff like that. And it was amazing. They all came out, I'm told, because I was in Vista in New York City, saying, we are black and we're proud and we want us some black power. It was, yeah. Stokely Carmichael, it was always in the paper, said this is one of the most dangerous Negroes in America. Well, he was, because he was saying, telling people who had been oppressed for generations and centuries that it's about time that you stand up, articulate what you need in terms of power to control your own destiny and lives, and by golly, you need to start doing it now. And like Brother Malcolm said, you need to be willing to do, utilize any means necessary to do it. He had a tremendous impact. The next morning, they organized a chapter of SNCC in Seattle, Washington. And then when I got back in September 67, 6 months later, I joined Seattle SNCC. I changed my name in New York to Abba Yoruba. What does that mean? It's an, okay, Abba means king, and Yoruba is a people that live in Nigeria, a very big tribe. So I had some illusions of grandeur. I'm not calling myself Abba Yoruba. But I couldn't make it stick. I couldn't make it stick when I got home. I said, man, first of all, I tried it on my mother at the airport. Mama walked right by me when I came to the airport. She had no idea who I was. And then until I said, Mama, you going by me? She came back, boy, what's wrong with you? Your daddy gonna cut your hair when you get home. Yeah, all that hair? No, Mama, daddy not gonna cut my hair. And come on, Larry, we're gonna go. By the way, Mom, my name is not Larry. It's Abba Yoruba. She, oh my God, I can't even say that. Boy, you better come on. Woo, we gonna have some trouble with you. What's wrong with you, boy? But I wasn't able to get the name fit, but I stayed involved in the movement. And then on Thanksgiving weekend, 1967, we went to the profoundly historically important Black Youth Conference in Los Angeles, California. And it was over Thanksgiving weekend, 4 days. Big impact, this conference. Big impact. Let me just give you a couple examples, and then I got to get to the finding of BSU, mention a couple things about the BSU, and then open it up. At this conference, Black youth from all, from Washington, Oregon, and California came together at a Black Power, we call it a Black Youth Conference. But at this conference, listen who was there. Some really courageous, tough-looking, disciplined brothers from Oakland, California. What did they call themselves? The Black Panther Party. The Black Panther Party. Some really bright and active brothers from San Francisco State, where 2 years before 1967, this is amazing, they had organized what became known as the Black Student Union. The Black Student Unions were only in California at this time. So that was how we got exposed to them. This is really important, and most of you are going to relate to this because you're going to remember what happened. A lot of high-level Black sports players, athletes, came too because they were trying to define a role for themselves. Listen, in 66, 67, 67, 68, Lou Alcindor, Lucius Ward, and I can't think of the third Black brother's name that started for UCLA on that year, but they all came to the Black youth trying to figure out and define what they want to do. The brothers that came down from San Jose State included Johnny Carlos and Tommy Smith, who became famous when they did the Black Power salute. All these Black athletes there, and they met in workshops, and they tried to figure out what they wanted to do as part of the Black Power movement. And they decided that we were going to boycott the 1968 Olympics. That's where the idea originated. It was at that Black Youth Conference. Thanksgiving, 67. We, 33 people, young blacks from Seattle, were so excited about the black student union movement that on the Greyhound bus going back, we elected officers for the Washington Association of Black Student Unions. And it was 30 of us on there, about 9 of us at the University of Washington. So naturally, we became the leaders of the effort to organize black student unions, as the sister that introduced me said. So that's how the black student union movement started. Lou Alcindor, Lucius Allen, and Mike Warren, that was their names, did not. This was back in the days, there was no pros playing basketball in the Olympics. It was the top college players in the country. UCLA was by far the best team in the country. They hadn't lost a game in, I think, 2 years, and not one black player on that team was willing to play for the Olympics as a way of showing solidarity with the rank and file black people of their country and by not participating in the 68 Olympics. Somehow, Tommy and John got talked into going, but they made a commitment that they would, if they could come in first, second place, in either the 100 or the 220, they would do the Black Power salute. They would have black shirts on, and that became a profoundly impactful symbol of black people wanting to be free in this country. But it wasn't until January 6, 1968 that we organized the University of Washington Black Student Union. At the University of Washington, and I want to mention a couple of facts and then open it up. At the University of Washington at that time, there was 35,600 students, January 1968. Of that number, remember, we're college students and we know how to do research. We could do a little something. Research, and we wanted to be relevant to our people, so we did the research. Only 63 black students, 4 Latinos, 2 Native Americans on the entire campus. There were only 2 black professors, and both of them were assistant professors, not full professors. Of the 600 men and women on the University of Washington campus that provided academic counselors, not one of them was black, Asian, Latino, Native American, or Pacific Islander. We didn't have time to look at all the classes, so we just took arts and humanities, about 1,200 courses. We could not find one course that used a book by an African American, Latino, Asian, or Native American. So E.J. Brisker, our president at that time, said, damn, okay, let's look at the articles, see if there's an article. Then we looked, and we couldn't find one class that used an article that was written by or the topic level of the article was about people of color. We called ourselves third world people back in those days. Had any information on black. So no wonder I was mentally the way I was when I went into Vista. I had not been exposed to anything that would make me aware of what was really happening. And even though we might laugh at the professors that told me black and Latino and Asian and Pacific Islander people never contributed anything worthwhile, or it certainly was not of historical value. Martin Luther King's right, we gotta separate people from their deeds and their actions and their behaviors. They just didn't know. They had never gotten anything that suggested that black people did anything historically relevant. Woody, they did not know that in Timbuktu, and a lot of us use Timbuktu to mean something way out. Oh, I'm gonna send you to Timbuktu, you keep talking. It means something uncivilized, bad. It's in Mali. Guess what? The top universities in the world were in Timbuktu in the 1100s. At the same time that Europe, I'm not trying to say that Timbuktu or Mali was superior, I'm just trying to share some historical facts that will help you to understand why we thought it was so important to have black history and black studies program on the college campuses. Europe was in the Dark Ages. That even in the Dark Ages, though, there were some Europeans that were bright enough and figured out a way that they wanted to go to the best colleges, and they figured out a way to get to Timbuktu so they can go to the best colleges in the world. There were Asians that went to there. And the civilization and the professors, the best professors, wanted to teach in Timbuktu. 1140, 1150, 1160. That was the year AD. Okay, I need y'all to know what years I'm talking about. But the point is that at that historical time, an African nation had the top universities in the world. So it's really difficult today to say that the reason we can't talk about African-American history is because we have to make it up. Or we have so many people in our society to say, why do those Negroes, all they think, they still call us Negroes, matter of fact. Why do those Negroes always, when something happens with our police? First time I went to jail, Larry Tukes knows this. Remember, I was born in Seattle. So the prosecuting attorney, Charles O'Carroll, after the Franklin sit-in, said, we got on TV, we got to do something about these outside agitators. And Woody, he named me and Carl and Aaron Dixon as outside agitators, I bought a picture of Aaron that I want to pass around because I want y'all to see it. He was a founder of the Black Panther Party for self-defense, and he got arrested with me at the Franklin sit-in in March of 1968, and we were in jail when Martin Luther King was killed, passed that around, in 1968. Guess what he said about me and Aaron? Aaron wasn't born in Seattle. He came here when he was five, but he lived in Seattle all his life. We cannot allow, said the prosecuting attorney of King County, because it wasn't Martin Luther King at that time, we cannot allow outside agitators to upset our Negroes. Listen to that concept. How are we his Negroes? He didn't think any much of that. We were black people that lived in Seattle, so I guess we're his. My basketball coach, I made second team All-City in Seattle, and I played in the first game in Washington State history where two all-black teams played each other. 1962 in Franklin High School. Played Garfield High School. It was the first time ever. Mayor Gordon Clinton, state representatives, the Seattle Times, the Seattle Post-Intelligencer, everybody was there because it was a historic game. First time 10 black high school basketball players ever played against each other. But my coach came and testified at my trial, and he said the following. When Larry played basketball, he was a good boy. And then he acted like frustration, like he had a lot of frustration in front of this all-white jury. I knew he was going to be found guilty. But now he's a bad boy because he advocates for black people to have power. Now, he didn't see no contradiction in that. Yeah, and the jury was over there nodding. And that was the shortest trial in King County history for 30 years. And the jury came out and said guilty. And then he said, remember, all of us were University of Washington, y'all school, don't forget this. Carl Miller, Aaron Dixon, and I were all University of Washington students. Not one of us had ever been in jail in our lives. And he pronounced the sentence, and it was 6 months in the county jail. And $1,500 fine, that's the most that you could possibly give for people involved in civil disobedience in Seattle, Washington. The reason I said Seattle, Washington, because I've talked about this topic around the country. They said, excuse me, Larry, weren't you talking about Jackson, Mississippi, or Birmingham, Alabama? No, y'all, I know my own hometown. All this happened in Seattle, Washington. So we organized the BSU. By May 19th, why is May 19th significant? Some of y'all got to know a little history. Historically, why is that an important day? I already mentioned his name. I'm trying to hint to y'all. Huh? Malcolm X's birthday. So we said that significantly, if the administration of the University of Washington doesn't come around by May 19th, we're going to take it over. And then I would like to say that we're human like everybody else. So some of us start vacillating. I got to show y'all this picture. This is heavy. Woody, this is Gordon D. Woody. We start vacillating. Oh, man, we ain't even gone to trial for the Franklin City, and some of us said. And we got some more organizing to do out at Bourne Middle School on that day. You know, all that stuff, that's secondary. We had set that as a date, told Dr. Odegaard that was the day we were going to do something if he didn't do the following. Recruit more Black, Asian, Latino, Native American, and Pacific Islanders, and this made us tremendously unique. Woody know this is true. Poor whites. We had class consciousness. Most Black nationalist student organizations did not make demands that their university be more responsive to the needs of poor whites. We did at the University of Washington. And when we won the battle, we set up the Asian and poor white disadvantaged something committee, and they recruited poor whites. Because some of y'all might call us communists, but we got exposed to some white boys that we really dug as students in study groups. Oh, you want to know their names? V.I. Lenin, Karl Marx, Frederick Engels, Che Guevara, etc. And, I read the Communist Manifesto when I was in Harlem, Woody. And before that, I was scared of it because Americans are taught to be scared of it. But when I read it and then talked to a couple of Black intellectuals in Harlem, I said, damn, this makes sense. Listen, Black people, 4 years from now, 4 years from now, we'll be celebrating. I'm on a national committee to celebrate the quadcentennial anniversary of the coming of African people to the United States of America, because it was in 1619 that the first Africans arrived in Jamestown, Virginia. And guess what? Between 1619 and about 1660, we were treated about the same as poor whites. We were indentured servants for 5 to 7 years, and then we get free. We could marry a white girl if we wanted to, buy some land after we did that indentured servitude, run for office, whatever. 1619 to 1660. But then in 1660, there was a tremendous need for more labor. The powers that be, I don't think they did it because they hated Black people. Logically, they found that they thought there was nearly an inexhaustible supply of African people that they could steal from Africa and bring over here to work for nothing, and they didn't want to deal with the static of only being able to work them 5 to 7 years. So they created a whole theoretical ideology, which we today call racism, and unfortunately it's still with us because we haven't dealt with it very well, and they start teaching that Blacks are by nature inferior to whites, and they're only endowed with the ability to be, and they found something in the Bible that said, thy servants should be obedient to thy master. And like some of y'all have seen on TV, every Sunday they brought their slaves out and read that passage 1,400 times to Black people. And they created separation between Blacks and whites through the implementation of an ideological system that divided poor whites from poor Blacks and from Native Americans, starting in the 1660s all the way. So we shouldn't expect that by 1770, when the Revolutionary War began, What had the British done? Oh, they taxed us without representing us. What are the Negroes in Baltimore doing? They're rebelling against what they think is a brutal murder of another black man by police officers, and it's completely unjust, and police had never been held accountable. This time, I am happy that they are going to at least be tried. And they fought. But Europeans started a revolution because the king was taxing them without adequately representing them. 1776, 1777, 1778, I can't remember when the Revolutionary War ended. But that was tremendous violence, y'all, over being taxed and not represented. There's never any people getting on TV for anything that black people do that might pretend serious, disruptive rebellion that most people think has any legitimacy whatsoever. Most people, there's always an exception, and that's a problem. So the reason I got this thing in me, we were getting this picture. Y'all can come and see it afterwards. Well, I'm gonna pass it around so I get through. Gordon DeWitty, born blind. He ain't never seen nothing. We were vacillating. The end of March, Julia, 1968, we'd already set May 19th as deadline. So some of us said we got to study, we might have a test that day. Gordon was listening to all this with his white cane in front of him. He said, hold it. Come on, y'all are jiving. And he stood up and listened to what he said. I was born blind. I can't see a lick. However, it is crystal clear to me that if we are to be taken serious as black students here at the University of Washington, we got to go forward and have this sit-in. Matter of fact, if none of y'all are going, I'm going by myself. Oh, it's hard for me to articulate the impact that that statement had on the rest of us. You didn't hear one of the 20 black students, and that's all we had in the BSU, because we only had 63 blacks on the campus. To have an impact for a sit-in, we had to go out in the community and get street brothers, the lumpen proletariat. Okay, they don't work, they hustle. But they was down for coming out here, and a lot of black student unions at Franklin, Garfield, Rainier Beach, that's how we got over 100 with it. I don't think the University of Washington knows that to this day. But Gordon is profoundly important in our history. And then we said, that there had to be ethnic cultural center set up where students of color would feel comfortable of interacting with one another around cultural things that they have in common, nothing wrong with that. And an ethnic cultural theater where writers and researchers and actors and singers would have something on campus that related to them. And next to last, we had to recruit more African-American counselors, professors, and other higher level staff. And then the final demand that we put forward was that black people be included in every major decision-making committee on the University of Washington campus. And if y'all don't adhere to these demands, the sky's the limit. This EJ, you know, he had to add this. The sky's the limit, and we're gonna achieve these goals by any means necessary. And then we sent them to the president. Then he decided that the money to implement all these things need to be in the BSU account. So he called the president back and said, I forgot. You need to we want $75,000 put in the BSU account by May 19th. Like the university could ever do something like that. But 75,000, we're mostly ghetto kids. We thought 75,000, we could recruit buku minority students, set up a black studies program, build the ethnic cultural center, everything. We just didn't know, because we never controlled anything. We didn't know nothing about money. Most any of us ever have was about $15 in our pocket. So that $75, when we had to sit in on May 19th, By September of 1968, the university set up a special education program to recruit more students. And guess what? 188 black students were brought in that September, 4 months later. 80 to 90 Latino, Chicano Latino students were brought in, maybe a few more. 67, there was a lot of Asians, but we thought that Filipinos and other low-income Asians need to be added. And Native Americans, they let in about 40 or 50. That was 300 to 400 minority students on a campus that began on University Avenue in 1861. And it never, ever in its 107-year history had more than 80 Latino, black, and African-American students on the campus at any time. And luckily for our state, for us, because by the time we had to sit in on May 19th, we had organized the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense on April 18th, 1968, in Seattle, Washington. And you know, a lot of brothers and a few sisters joined the Black Panthers. They liked the militancy of the Black Panther up here in northern urban cities. So maybe by the time we had to sit in, there was 150 Panthers in Seattle, and about 35 of them joined us at the sit-in. But luck, I'm closing now. Luckily, I feel, because I spoke at his funeral, that Dr. Odegaard saw the wisdom and said the university needs to do the right thing. And he signed off on all those demands I just mentioned to you. And then strategically, we were pretty strategic, because there's always progressive-minded whites that are willing to support. But we only allowed Robbie Stern to sit in with us. But the other whites, about 300 of them, we said, y'all go around the administration building. Just stand around the administration, because when the police come, they're not going to go through white students. Y'all are the daughters and sons of some pretty influential people around here, I mean, in Washington State. So, and then we found out later, Woody, that one of the considerations of the police during the 4 hours of the sit-in was that if we rushed the black students, then, pass this around, if we rushed the black students, then we're going to have to go through these whites. And they had some trouble doing that. Again, back to Baltimore. For some reason, because black men who are poor are so dangerous, we don't give as much value to their lives. That's why this concept, Black Lives Matter, has been such an important concept around our nation in recent months. It's just very difficult for me. I get calls. White people call me and say, oh, you sound all right, but you don't sound like the other 8 people on the county council. We got a place where you can go, Julian, and take some speaking lessons. You need to learn how to talk. You can't talk. In other words, I don't sound white middle class, so they think something's wrong with me. I can't really be a politician because I don't sound like a real politician. They don't have any history. Thank you very much. Thank you. Somebody tell me, how many minutes do we have for a few questions? Because I want to hear what's, huh? What?
We
got until 7:30?
Yeah.
And it's already 7:30?
Yeah.
Okay, 2 or 3 questions, but those of you who have to go, we understand, because it's already 7:30. Anybody got any questions? I'm going to call on you, but I was trying to give somebody else a chance. So go ahead, bro.
If you do have a question, you can use the microphone.
Oh.
So,
I'm getting back at him.
You want to go first?
No. You go first, man. We called on you.
So I got a quick question. So everything that you were talking about, or resolved around 1960s era.
Yeah, yeah. Because so, the starting of the Black Student Union movement. Yeah.
Got it. I was wondering if you ever read the Kerner Report that came out in 1967, or 1968, I believe. Mm-hmm. I actually just read it like 2 days ago.
Oh.
And it's pretty crazy, like you're talking about
separate, hostile, and unequal.
And so, actually, I'm going to just read the first 12 really quick.
First what, 12?
The first level of intensities. So, for those who don't know what the Kerner Report is, can I give a quick preview?
Yeah.
Is that okay? So, Kerner Report is just during the Detroit riots in the 1960s.
Detroit, Newark.
Newark, yep. Lyndon B. Johnson had a commission to go out and see why are all these black people going crazy, pretty much. And so the first levels of why we are going crazy was police practices, unemployment and underemployment, inadequate housing, inadequate education, poor recreational facilities, and so on and so forth. My question to you is, as a politician in the Seattle area, what do you see that's changing for the black community in that area, and what are you doing to change those? Because I feel those are still prevalent in the reasons why we are still the way that we are and why the dominant society of white supremacy is still functioning the way that it is. So how are you pretty much going through that?
Thank you. I think that most of the social ills that the brother, what's your name?
Cedric.
That Cedric just outlined are still with us today. But I would be less than honest with you if I didn't say I see some areas where we have improved as a nation. In 1964, when they did a study of Seattle's black community, about 50, that's why I mentioned about Harlem in 66, about 50% of all the families that lived in Seattle lived at or below the poverty level. Today, about 60% of black families in King County make incomes of between $45,000 and $95,000 a year. So it's 55 to 60% middle income. That's a significant difference. But on February 2nd, there was a front page article in the Seattle Times, and this is going to really reinforce what you just said. And I hope that some of you will get this because y'all are researchers. Here's the title. The rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. That's the name of the article I'd like for some of y'all to read. Here's what the article essentially says. That the black households in Seattle, overall household income is plummeting in relation to most other big cities. They looked at the 100 biggest cities in the country, and they found that the black families in Seattle make $25,700 on average. And the average white family in Seattle makes between $70,000 and $72,000 annual income. And one of the problems is that, and Mayor Ed Murray, who's mayor of Seattle right now, has been constantly pointing this out for the last 2 months, that his demographers say that about 55% of all black kids, this is where the problem comes in Seattle, live in the households that are real poor. Poor people have a disproportionate number of kids. Those middle-class families I mentioned to you have very few kids. So we have half of all the kids under the age of 18 and who are black in Seattle don't have anywhere near the amount of basic money that they need to cover their basic needs. So consequently, they're out in the streets, they're dropping out. The dropout rate for Seattle Public Schools today is 42%. The dropout rate in Seattle Public Schools in 1978 was 42%, no increase. However, because of the University of Washington EOP program, between 1968 and 1977, we went from 63 black students to 1,666. But then just 20 plus years later, 1998, something called I-200 was passed and said the blacks are making so much progress in Washington State, oh, they're making progress, that we got to end affirmative action as we have known it. And I worked hard, and a lot of other people are against it, but it still passed. So we're only the second state in the union that killed affirmative action, and it really has. That's why I was glad that on this campus, on Bothell campus, and on Seattle campus, recently, Black Student Union and other students were raising contradictions about how few minority and low-income students are on these three campuses. So the struggle still continues. But there have been some improvements. There's still some serious problems. Yes?
Hi, my name is
Kenesha. Give him five later.
Okay, my name is Kenesha Johnson from...
Teachers?
No, Kenesha Johnson.
Lanisha, all right.
Kenesha, like Kenny, like Kenya. You spell like Kenny and put the S-H-A. Kenesha Johnson.
Okay, Kenesha.
I'm Kenesha Johnson from Tacoma Community College, the OBI, but Black Student Union now. And I'm a secretary, and I'm special ed with Asperger's autism. I have Asperger's autism, and I believe that we need to stick her... This is a comment. We need to stand our game up. I'm sick of people hunting up gang signs, doing no game for it. And Black people have been ignorant to me since day one, since I've been born back in 93. I think it's time to believe in our change and make a difference come true, like Michelle Obama and Obama, because I believe that they're making the progress to embrace the trace of the Rashad Shihoda, what you got to say, what you got to say. And I believe... that I want to be the, do you know Ernestine Anderson, the blues singer from Seattle, Washington?
I know her very well.
My grandma.
Oh, okay.
I'm her.
We named the building after her on 22nd Jackson. Then we
yep,
let her.
It's the Ernestine Housing.
Yeah.
Yes, power to the people.
For elders.
I want to take the stand to be the next something big. I want to get back to the community, to come to Washington and base the trade. I want to get you guys rich. We need money. We need money in the hilltop. We need to embrace the power for the expectations, hold up the law enforcement, and step our game up and take it back and have the power of the people. Yes, we can make a dream come true because I'm a superwoman on the brakes of the chase. Amen.
All right, but one practical suggestion. The BSU on your junior college should get together with UW Tacoma and UPS, listen, and the Lincoln and Foss high school BSUs. And y'all just get together and figure out what you think you can do here in Tacoma, okay, sister? Because you's bad.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, I would like to thank y'all for coming out. It's been a pleasure.